I wish to portray a concept of mind, of thinking, of intelligence that is not restricted to language. Any limited view of intellect will penalize students whose aptitudes reside outside its boundaries. If schools aim at cultivating intellect, those whose aptitudes lie in forms of thinking that are excluded from the accepted concept of intellect will also be excluded from a place in our educational sun. Elliot Eisner. Covering the life and works of Elliot Eisner in a nutshell is no easy task, as he wrote over 30 books and research reports and almost 300 articles throughout his career. Even the number of central topics and issues he concerned himself with were multitudinous and varied. For the purposes of this project, we will explore the case he made for the arts in public schools and follow the progression of his argument as it developed over time.
To begin, Eisner started making his case for the arts in scholarly publications during the 1960s, and his efforts grew through his early thinking about the arts and creativity and the need for them in our schools. He recognized that the lack of the arts and the prominence of standards and standardized tests had resulted in a lack of appreciation for creative thinking in the classroom. Rote memory and the single way to a final answer ruled. Eisner's vision of the public school was one where standards might exist, but instead of dominating the curriculum, they work side by side with artistic approaches to developing curriculum and assessing students' performance. In an article titled Curriculum Ideas in a Time of Crisis, Eisner makes a call to action concerning the arts. Perhaps we can now identify the crisis in art education. I believe it is a crisis of making the most of a period of opportunity. I believe this period of unlimited promise for the field of art education. Our crisis is now. The students are ready. The parents are ready. The country is ready. Will we be ready? This call to action was a call driven by a direct lack of subject matter that was important to Eisner personally. He is making a case for something that he is passionate about because he sees that the attention given to it at the time is damaging any real experience that students could have with the curriculum content. This would mark the direction of his work for a long time to come. While Eisner's initial focus was primarily on bringing attention to the arts and the lack of it in the American curriculum, he also wanted to point out that art did not need to be siloed from other subjects, or that it had a monopoly over creativity. He writes, "Now, developing creativity is a fine thing, and I believe art educators should attend to it. But let us not delude ourselves. Art education has no franchise upon creativity." This is an important factor in Eisner's thinking because while he endeavored to bring art education to the front lines of the discussion, he also made the argument that the responsibility for art education and creativity belongs to all. There is an art in all subject matter, from math to English to science, and teachers should not leave it up to the art teacher only to engage students in creative modes of expression. Eisner furthers his argument in another piece from the same time frame. He writes, "Once considered an elusive, almost mystical gift to a special few, creativity is now being seen as a common capacity to all, one that should be effectively developed by the school." Eisner's passion for art fit neatly into the absence he saw in the school curricula, and as a matter of progression in his work, he saw an opportunity to address the art curriculum development and teachers' pedagogy as well. Eisner observed that the movement towards standards and standardized tests was creating a culture in our schools completely devoid of anything that he would call creativity or the arts. In his piece, Educational Connoisseurship and Criticism, Their Form and Functions in Educational Evaluation, Eisner writes that education in America conceives of knowledge as scientific and believes that precision is a function of quantification. He admits, "This tradition has made important contributions to the conduct of education, but as an exclusive mode of inquiry, it possesses limits which in the long run exclude more from our understanding than they include." And notice Eisner pointing out, as he did in Curriculum Ideas in a Time of Crisis, that the time has come for creativity in art. He continues, "The time is ripe for broadening the base from which inquiry and education can go forward. It is time for a more Catholic sense of possibility. We need, in my opinion, to widen our epistemology. The rigidity of standards honors the movement towards the sciences and assumes the measurability of student progress. But Eisner wanted to invite nuance into his curriculum. He wanted the support, the opportunity to engage with more than one way to find or discover an answer." In another work, What Can Education Learn from the Arts About the Practice of Education? Eisner states, there can be more than one answer to a question and more than one solution to a problem. Variability of outcome is okay. To Eisner, uniformity was not necessarily a virtue in education. It would have value to us as educators if we wanted to compare our students with other American students or students from other countries, but, he asks, why should we wish to make such comparisons? This is an important question for Eisner in his time, as well as for those of us reading his work, earlier works today. His point is still as critical as it was before, and the question is still as timely. In fact, we can hear how prescient many of his quotes are about standardizing education. For example, he writes, if educational objectives were really useful tools, teachers, I submit, would use them. If they do not, perhaps it is not because there is something wrong with the teachers, but because there might be something wrong with the theory. And where is it written that every subject has to be taught for the same reasons to 45 million students? Despite the effort to achieve professional consensus about the educational agendas of specific subjects, the virtue of uniformity is, to my mind, questionable. And the aim of education is not to train an army that marches to the same drummer, at the same pace, toward the same destination. Such an aim may be appropriate for totalitarian societies, but it is incompatible with democratic ideals. Eisner suggested that if we were to think about applying what he called the aesthetic experience to curriculum in our schools, that students and teachers would have to become connoisseurs of their art. Only after they were connoisseurs could they become critics. He writes, if the child is viewed as an art product and the teacher as a critic, one task of the teacher would be to reveal the qualities of the child to himself and to others. In addition, the teacher as critic would appraise the changes occurring in the child. But because the teacher's task includes more than criticism, he would also be responsible, in part, for the improvement of the work of art. In short, in both the construction of educational means, the curriculum, and the appraisal of its consequences, the teacher would become an artist, for the criticism itself, when carried to its height, is an art. This, it seems to me, is a dimension to which curriculum theory will someday have to speak. Teaching is an art, he argues, that moves beyond simple best practices and into the nuances of teaching, what he considers the collection of small choices that make a teacher and his or her classroom what it is. Good teaching depends upon artistry and aesthetic considerations. It is increasingly recognized that teaching, in many ways, is more like playing a jazz quartet than following the score of a marching band, knowing when to come in and take the lead, knowing when to bow out, knowing when to improvise are all aspects of teaching that follow no rule. They need to be felt. This notion was not only something standardization denied of its students. As a matter of concatenation, it affected the teacher's claim to artistry as well. Eisner argues that we need to understand artistry, that is, how people learn to make things well. Artistry is more likely when we acknowledge its relevance to teaching and create the conditions in schools in which teachers learn to think like artists. To Eisner, to think like an artist is to live like an artist, a notion that is opposed to the current standardized setup of our schools. He contends, a lesson that the arts can teach education is importance of taking one's time to relish the experience that one seeks. Experience is not so much something that you take, it is more like something you make. Experience, the medium of education, is a made process, and it is made by the ways in which people attend to aspects of the world they care about. The arts are about savoring. This notion from Eisner's later work fits nicely into his earlier work from the 60s, where he called for a greater depth of knowledge and deeper understanding of an art medium. In a similar manner, he argued for that need in education itself. He asked those who wished to make changes in education to slow down, and like the artists, focus on the experience of the art of education.